right. Thanks, everyone. My name is Zack Loebel-Begelman. I'm a software engineer on one of the data analytics teams at Credit Karma.
Yeah, I'm Dustin Lyons, also an engineer working primarily in data analytics at Credit Karma on Zack's team. So today we're here to talk to you about Akka Streams for large-scale data processing, and we'll talk about what that means soon. Okay, so sometime in 2014, and I've been with the company around 2 years, Zack, as well, this is what data looked like at Credit Karma. Very high level, but what you see here essentially is, you know, we had moved from using a lot of MySQL, very relational structured data. We moved to wanting to look at data in a more unstructured way, or semi-structured way. So we moved to Kafka. And so in 2014, we invite Kafka into our stack, and we primarily just push data into Kafka from our monolithic app, our microservices. And we need to pull that data out into our data warehouse for our analysts to consume. So 2014, we built a service in Scala using Akka Actors to pull the data out of Kafka, subscribe to a topic of analytics coming in, and push that into Vertigo. So 2014 is basically what it looked like. Now, sometime in 2015, we partnered with a company called Amplitude. Amplitude is like a mixed panel, if you've heard of mixed panel. Essentially just allowing us to understand how people use our mobile products. So we're very interested to see how people behave on their apps. Are they using the features we're shipping? What's the behavior they do? So we partnered with Amplitude to help us interface with that data. So in sometime 2015, we built another application similar to the data warehouse import service, also using Scala Akka Actors, to basically export that data out of Amplitude and ingest it into Kafka, where we can then consume it into our data warehouse. So 2015, Akka Actors again for the analytics export service, and this is what we want to talk to you about today. These two services we built, we chose Akka Actors, why we chose that originally, and ultimately when we moved to Akka Streams, why we did that, and sort of the trade-offs and the learning that we had along the way.
So we said large-scale data processing. We want to make sure that we are very specific about what exactly that scale is. So in 2014, when we first introduced Kafka, we were moving about 160 megs every minute. This isn't a LinkedIn, this isn't or Facebook, but it certainly is. It's not a small number. It's enough to where it's non-trivial. So we introduced Kafka, and people were still getting comfortable logging semi-structured data, leveraging the data pipeline. So the next year, we actually doubled that number. And so there's a trend here. I want to make sure everyone notices, because that's what caused us to want to use Actors to start with, is it's doubling. Already this year, we've doubled that number again. We're up to 617 megs every minute, and that's just year to date. People are continuing to use this pipeline and push more data into it, so we know it's going to continue growing. We wanted to make sure that we would use a technology that could scale as people continue to push data in and could grow with the pipeline. That's why everywhere we touch the core data pipeline, we use Scala or Java, something on the JVM, so that we have that nice concurrency that you don't necessarily get with other single-threaded scripting languages or others. And I want to make sure to point out the number, 700,000 events every minute. That's what we're pushing into the data pipeline today. So if we don't match that number, we'll fall behind. If we fall behind, we'll never catch up. If we're not processing that 700K every minute, then we'll never necessarily catch up. So I said we wanted to pick something that could allow us to scale easily. That was why we initially picked Akka Actors. So the actor model was introduced in the 70s by Carl Hewitt. It's a paradigm for concurrent programming. The idea is provide a message, the actor responds with the message or does some side effect. This was, as I said, initially implemented in Erlang. It's been re-implemented by the folks at Akka in Scala. This works very well for low latency programs. Send a message, get one back, or do some side effect. It all happens very quickly. All the mutable state is contained within your actor, so that also means it scales very well, something we were looking for. Scales very well across threads or across boxes, because everything is contained within the actor. Your only interaction is those messages. So let's talk about this application we built with Akka Actors. So down here, you can see we have our data warehouse import service. So we have a number of topics in Kafka. Each of those is semantically equivalent to a schema that we have defined outside of this box and to a table in Vertica. So we have about 60 of those today. When we started, we had something like 12, and we'll spin up an extractor for every topic in Kafka. That extractor will then spin up three child actors. It'll spin up a reader whose job it is to get a message from Kafka. That reader, once it receives a message, sends that along to the deduplicator. Now, because Kafka only provides at least once messaging guarantees, sometimes you get duplicates. That's the point of the deduplicator here. Is this, again, mutable state being contained, has a little hash set of, hey, what messages have I seen? If it sees another message, or if it sees a duplicate, it'll drop it. Otherwise, it'll forward that message along to the processor. Processor says, okay, I have JSON here. I need to convert this into a format Vertica understands. Again, semi-structured to a relational columnar store. Sometimes you need to massage it a little bit. So that's what the processor does. Once the processor is done with its processing, sends its message back to the extractor, who restarts that whole process and sends a message off to say, hey, let's go load this into Vertica. So this worked very well for quite a while. It worked so well that when it came time to build our next service, the analytics export service, we looked to use the same technology.
Yeah, and so, you know, as Zach has said, we really liked Akka Actors. And we'd actually even built another system at Credit Karma we had a lot of success with. A system that helped us do some model evaluation with our data science team. So we found from that success, hey, let's use Actors everywhere. We were pretty naive at the time. And so we built this analytics export service, very similar problem domain that Zach was solving, where we're just trying to pull data from a source, ingest it into Kafka. For us, we needed some actor here. It's a coordinator that pulled data out of Amplitude. They provide a RESTful API to serve up data as files. And then we basically would pass that through what Akka provides is a router of actors, essentially a group of workers that you could pass through. So we're coordinating, we're pulling data out, and we're passing it into a group of workers to transform the data to a format that we make sense of in our world, so transforming from Amplitude's data schema to ours. And then ultimately, another group of actors that would import that data into what we have, an HTTP ingest service. So we have a server that sits on the front end that allows us to provide some validation as things come in. So we're pulling data out of Amplitude that we wanted to leverage, pushing that through a group of workers to transform the data, finally ending up in our HTTP service. So, you know, fairly naive, we thought, great, actors are great, let's build this and let's see how this behaves. And so in our initial testing, in our initial rollout, we started seeing some problems. So what were those problems?
Lack of back pressure.
Yeah, sorry.
And getting ahead, but right idea.
Sorry.
Something seems to have frozen up.
Something seems to have frozen. Here we go. Okay. So, features are timing out. Why are features timing out? So, in the beginning, these transformation workers that you were seeing, they're working very, very fast. So as we're pulling data in, we're transforming data. It's a very fast process. But in reality, upstream or downstream, the workers that were sending outbound to HTTP were actually slow. They were slower actors. So what we're seeing is those actors that are going outbound to HTTP, that call needs a thread as it's waiting back for the response. There's only so many threads available. So as these very, very fast actors are pushing this work to these slow actors, we're saturating that thread pool. And as a result, new requests coming in are waiting for a thread to latch onto to go outbound, and we're seeing this problem where there's no futures available. So this is one of the first problems we started seeing. It was, oh, okay, we don't have enough threads. Futures are timing out. What's the issue? So, very common, you know, out of memory errors. So we also started seeing this where, you know, these very fast workers in the beginning are pushing a lot of work to a slow actor who's basically all that work is just queuing up in memory. So very fast actors are queuing up this work that we have to go outbound in HTTP, queuing it up in memory, and as a result, we just blow up the heap space. So again, this problem of controlling the rate as we're moving data through our actor system, ultimately we're not doing a good job of that. And as a result, we're seeing these errors in production. So we weren't very happy with these problems. And around the same time, you know, our naive approach to Akka Actors also started to surface in problems Zach was solving.
So it was around that same time that I started seeing problems in a different vein. So what I want to point out here is this is a run of our data warehouse export service. We have reads from Kafka on the left in millions, and we have minutes since the beginning. So as you can see, we start up and we're doing great. We hit 9 million, and then it comes crashing down. This came almost out of the blue, and I realized, okay, we had a new schema come online. So this new schema, a new topic in Kafka, was 10x, our previous one. So before, our previous one was around, I want to say, 30,000 events every minute. This new schema was more on the order of 300,000 events every minute. And so all of a sudden, the application couldn't keep up. We knew the symptoms, and we had an idea about the cause, but we didn't know how to fix it, or the root cause, really. So I just want to point out what's happening here. This is our 700K line that's drawn out, where if we're not going that fast, we're falling behind. As you can see, we're falling behind a majority of the time. It shoots up, it does a lot of work, and then crashes down to almost nothing. We even have a 20-minute period where we don't even process any events. So we're unclear what exactly is happening. We just know it's going really slow. It's churning into swap space, which is never good for any JVM process. And it has these almost halting moments where it's almost as though it's not responding. It's not doing anything. So we weren't sure what the problem was. And it was around this time we decided, hey, let's look to the community to see if other people have had similar problems. Maybe there's a solution out there.
Yeah, so around this time we found Akka Streams. So Akka provides another API, actually built on top of Akka Actors. It's a streaming API. And essentially the idea is moving to a pull-based model instead of a push-based model. So it invites this idea of some demand into your stream. So before, where I was having these workers pull data out of the Amplitude service, pushing it forward to the other actors responsible for ingesting that, that's a more of a push-based model. So Akka Streams allows the slower actor downstream who has a discrete amount of threads available to go outbound to basically say, hey, I'm ready for work, to pull work in from other actors upstream that would be pushing that work. So it's this fundamental idea of pulling instead of pushing. This, as our friend here, Paul, mentioned that back pressure is this fundamental concept is called back pressure. So this was formalized in the reactive stream spec, and this isn't like a blocking system. These are non-blocking asynchronous calls that actors can send to each other to tell each other to slow down based on work they are processing. So it's this fundamental idea of, you know, having fast publishers and slow subscribers. They need to be able to communicate so they can coordinate the work so we don't have the problems that you saw earlier that I showed on the screen. So this idea, it's built for high throughput. It's built to prevent bottlenecks in your stream. What we are trying to do is build actor systems and solve these problems ourselves. In reality, Akka Streams, the API they provide, does this for you. So it's a fantastic thing that we found. And so we began looking at how do we, you know, change, you know, our naive approach to do something like this based on sort of the research and the problems that we were seeing in production.
So I'm going to take a few minutes to talk about some of the building blocks of Akka Streams. So when you have a simplified pipeline, there's really three core building blocks that come together. The first part of the stream is your source. A source effectively means that as far as the stream is concerned, you have no inputs and one output. So a source can be from any number of places. It can be from a file, it can be from a sequence in memory, but as far as the stream is concerned, the source is kind of where it all starts. So the only thing that's exposed is the output that goes along. So if you want to plug that in and do some other processing or something on top of that, you use what's called a flow. These are all shapes, with the idea being all of these shapes fit together. So a flow has exactly one input and one output. So you'll notice, we'll talk about some of the built-in APIs. It's a lot of the standard collections APIs where we're dealing with immutable data effectively. So okay, we want to map everything. You have one input, one output. It's kind of the same thing. So once you have a flow, that goes along to a sync. A sync having one input with zero outputs, at least as far as the stream is concerned. The idea here is that it's to a side effect or something outside of the stream system. So once you connect all of these pieces together, you have a blueprint. You have a runnable graph. The idea being that a runnable graph is freely shareable across threads or across boxes even, and can be run and instantiated. That's when the stream actually starts processing. And that's done in the background asynchronously. So these are just some of the simple pieces. I want to make sure to call out that this is for a kind of straightforward graph where you have, you know, one item or one type of item flowing through. You can build much more complicated ones where you have maybe multiple inputs and a single output or multiple inputs to multiple outputs, things like that. These are really just for the simple cases, and It provides a lot of niceties because it all connects together. You get compile time checks and you know what objects you're interacting with because they're all just kind of functions dealing with a single input. If you're building more advanced graphs, you lose some of that nicety. So let's talk about some of the APIs that you get out of the box. These are things you don't need to write any custom code to take advantage of, and should look pretty familiar to you if you've used Akka or even the Scala Collections API. So some of the sources that you can use just out of the box, as I said, a sequence from memory, you can have a file on disk, or you can have an iterator. And again, all of these have that back pressure built in where it knows how to slow down. It also has some really nice actor integrations where you can have an actor reference just published or just exposed, such that just messages are sent of whatever's interacting with the stream, either as a source or a sync. Or you can also use a subscriber or publisher trait. These are more kind of formalized versions of, well, they're effectively a source or a sync, but they're formalized. Dustin mentioned the reactive streams, the idea being your publisher is something that creates it. And by inheriting from those traits, it forces you to kind of think about, oh, what are my back pressure options here? Do I want to buffer items until I get to a certain amount? Do I want to just handle one item at a time? It forces you to think about that when you're trying to implement these methods on an actor that you're going to integrate with. And some of these processing stages also are just very nice and easy to work with. Again, very familiar if you've used this Collections API. You have maps, drop while, sliding, filters, all just work out of the box and can be operated on a stream with those same semantics you'll use from the collections. A few others we want to call out is there are back pressure aware stages. So if you know that you have a fast publisher and a slow subscriber, you can kind of handle some of those cases explicitly by providing one of these back pressure stages to say, okay, let's buffer up items and we'll drop extras or whatever that might be. If you're in Dustin's case, you might want to say, hey, let's do a map async here because this actor is really slow. We want to do many at a time. Let's kick it off to run eight at a time, let's say. So let's talk about what it looked like to convert some of this stuff that I built into streams. So I want to look closely at what we're doing here. The extractor will send a message to the reader to say, hey, go get a message from Kafka. Once the reader has a message, sends that along to the deduplicator. Deduplicator says, hey, is this duplicate? Is this not? And then it will drop the message if it's a duplicate. Otherwise, it passes it along to the processor. Processor does a little bit of processing in memory, passes it back to the extractor. Without realizing it, we had actually created a simplified version of Akka Streams. So the idea here is that our unit of back pressure was effectively this whole flow. So we only ever had one item at a time. The extractor was effectively providing a simplified version of back pressure because it wouldn't kick off this again until it got a message. So because these were all actors and the state was contained within each, it was actually very straightforward to transform it into a stream. And it actually winds up a much cleaner, simpler implementation. So let's see what that looks like right here. Just like that, boom, we have a stream. So it actually winds up being easier to reason about. We wind up creating a single stream for each extractor without having to worry about wiring up all the actors, making sure all the types are correct, and only having those messages. And also we have back pressure every step of the way. So let's take a look at the code here. So as I said before, we have a runnable graph. We use our from iterator. This stream.iterator is actually an iterator provided by Kafka. We create our source. We turn it into a type that everything else in the pipeline understands, our Kafka message with metadata. We created a custom graph stage, a deduplicator, because that didn't come out of the box, so we had to implement it ourselves. But it was fairly straightforward to just convert our existing actor implementation to do that. Again, all the state is contained within this graph stage. So the idea here is we just move that logic here, we create a new one. This via method pretty much means, hey, plug in your custom graph stage here and it'll go. It's still just one-to-one, even though sometimes it drops messages, it's still not creating other outputs. Once we have that, we run it through our processor. This was already, there wasn't any state necessarily, the only thing being what schema it was, so we had a little bit of startup, but we just run it through a map, and then we send it off to our actor subscriber to push to Vertica. And again, because we used that subscriber trait, we had several different options of how we might want to control kind of the back pressure. So once we have that, we have our runnable graph, and this is still contained within an actor, that extractor I had pointed out. And once we get our start extraction method saying, hey, all of our guys are ready to go, let's start actually running these streams, we just call run. And just like that, you actually have a now compile time safe implementation without having to worry about wiring all those actors up, and it actually winds up significantly more performant. And we'll come back to that later.
Yeah, and so similar scenario where I'm taking my old first approach using Akka Actors, moving that over to an Akka Stream. So very similar, we're able to just take things away. Won't be as exciting, boom, as Zach. But essentially, you know, same kind of thing, where we're able to really consolidate a lot of work into one unit, one actor. So for us, there was an actor responsible for streaming the data instead of our first approach, which was many actors trying to control back pressure and all this stuff ourselves. So how does the code look? Very similar. So for me, I'm actually using, for my source, I was using the file editor, the file source. So you can essentially just stream out of files, framing the files by new lines. And then you'll see, and so just various maps through parsing. I do some matching here where I need to filter out certain events. I have a transform function, and then I send on to a data pipeline. So, you know, I was able to really consolidate 3 or 4 different classes, lots of work into this one runnable graph that you can see here. So, pretty straightforward, awesome to reason about, much easier to maintain, and also very much, very well performant. So, how did this look before? So I mentioned that the heap space was not that great. This was me trying to control work, trying to control back pressure in my system, not doing a good job of it. So in the beginning, you'll see a lot of the work was queuing up from Amplitude. We're transforming that, and we're all just waiting to go outbound over HTTP. So not the best. Heap size just blows up. We're not very happy. But Akka Streams, you know, same data we're pushing. This is what Akka Streams look like. So just much more consistent, much more predictable, and obviously about a third less of the memory consumption. So we're doing the same amount of work here. We're just doing it using Akka Streams versus a homegrown actor system. So something to note, you know, I might have been able to come up with this, building an actor system. I mean, eventually, right, I could have managed to control something in my actor system to get it down to this, but why do that, right? Akka Streams just provides this great API to do it for you. So you'll see here, this is just obviously what we wanted to see. This was fantastic.
So I was still kind of haunted by this graph. This was what we had seen in production, and I had a lot of trouble replicating it. It finally, we set up a node in the cloud where we had a 5-node Kafka cluster. We put 100 million events in, and I figured that would be enough. And so it was at that point where I started to see some of that same kind of halting, sluggish behavior. So let's take a minute to talk a little bit about, here are some garbage collection graphs from that same run. We have our V1 up top here, and we have our Akka Streams down here. So note the two different colors. These are old gen GCs. These are only new gen GCs. So I'm going to take a second to just briefly go into how the G1 garbage collector works. That's what we were using. There's two types of garbage collections. Garbage collection obviously is the reason we use the JVM. You don't need to manually deal with your own memory. It's one of the nice things you get, but sometimes it can bite you. So the G1 garbage collector has two styles, a new gen and an old gen. For new gen, it's incrementally cleaning up newly created objects. For our old gen, there's something called a stop the world event. Now, JVM programmers should be very familiar with this. This is actually what we were seeing. So you have a stop the world event. You do some pointer math to see, hey, what's still being used, what's not. You allow the program to continue, and then you stop the world again and see, hey, which references are still valid, which aren't. Let's clean up those objects. So note the time difference here. For our old gen GCs that were occurring at the top, we're on the order of 20 to 25 seconds. And not just a few, like several, right? We have several over the period of a few minutes. This is that behavior we were seeing, that halting, that slowness, that we weren't processing everything. We were literally creating objects faster than we could clean them up. I suspect that was because we were kind of using the best practice when you have Akka Actors is you create a case class each time you send a message to some other actor. So that meant for each time it went through the pipeline, we were creating 5 objects for a single event out of Kafka. As I said, we were literally creating objects faster than we could clean them up. And if we were churning into swap space, that means that swap needs to be pulled from disk into memory just to be GC'd. So we're looking at exactly what we were seeing. You're barely processing anything at that point. That was the problem we found. So once we made the switch over to streams, we don't even have any old gen GCs. We just have new gen GCs on the order of like 40 to 80 milliseconds. It's not even a stop the world event. So a significant improvement. So what are the big learnings here? Akka Actors are really great for low latency. If you want to do something real fast and respond, a web service, Akka Actors work very well. But if you're trying to go for high throughput where you want to move as much data as you can, use Akka Streams. They're still built on top of Akka Actors, but it's been built by the folks at Typeset or Lightbend, who understand those APIs a lot better and have provided a compile time safe implementation that is instead optimized for high throughput.
Yeah, and you know, as I said earlier, As I said earlier, you know, you could eventually probably build this stuff yourself. You can manage back pressure yourself, but just don't do that. Just use Akka Streams. Like, don't be like us. Don't go have these problems that you know you have in production and you're like, what do we do wrong? Your naive approach. Use Akka Streams. It's a great API for high throughput problems. When you're trying to move things without bottlenecks, use Akka Streams. Build a network service, as Zach said, use Akka Actors. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Back.
No, we were using Akka Streams after Kafka.
Well, both. For in Dustin's case, we were using Akka Streams to push data to an HTTP server that sat on top of Kafka. And then in the after case, we were reading from Kafka, pushing into the streams, and then writing off to our column store. The question was if we're using Akka Streams before and after. And the answer is yes, but we're not directly integrating with Kafka on both sides.
So because it says stream, does it have any implication in the stream process?
So let me be clear about this is using Kafka 8.2 or .8.2. So this is, there's no actually Kafka streams here. This is purely just the consumer producer API. We're not using any of the new Kafka features. This is more so about
just the streaming API from Akka.
From Akka, yes.
So if you get a producer and subscriber model, then why not just source it directly and use Kafka and then let the consumers consume it? So how Akka stream makes a difference?
So the question was, why not just use the APIs directly?
From the Kafka streaming API?
No, we can use directly Kafka, right? You have source, you push it to Kafka, and then the consumers can consume it. So how Akka Stream makes your solution better?
Well, so it's kind of the story we were telling, right? Is we initially did that, but we were using those APIs with Akka Actors. And so we noticed we started to get bottlenecks appearing. And so we had problems with it. Because we wanted to consume a lot and we wanted to do it highly concurrently, we chose to use actors for our concurrency method effectively. And we started hitting lots of problems. So that was why we converted to use Akka Streams. So it's just a different way to do concurrency once you get those items from Kafka. Mm-hmm. Right? We still had the problem of, hey, we want to read 700,000 events and push it and do some stuff and push it somewhere else. So we wanted a toolkit to do that without necessarily having to implement all the concurrency code ourselves in Scala. Does that answer your question?
Yes, it does. Yeah. And then the side question.
Can we follow up after to see another question?
What strategy do you use for high availability and distributing actors across machines?
So that's a good question. We actually found that for these specific problems, at least from my side, well, first off, Kafka gives that to you out of the box, but we found that we were able to do a lot of this processing just on a single box, where we would just allocate the resources for, hey, you're just gonna do this one thing, use as many threads as you need, and it was a pretty beefy box. But at least for my perspective for scaling, because the Kafka consumer scales across boxes, we could just use that ourselves, but we haven't quite hit that problem yet. Dustin, sort of?
Yeah. I mean, I guess we haven't dived into looking. I think with Akka Streams, you lose some of the clustering benefits. And so, Zach said we leverage Kafka there, and essentially, you know, I've done some work where we just split it up across machines, but I'm
partition on time effectively for Dustin's, because it's a batch load from an analytics service. So it was more like, hey, let's partition it week by week. So you box, you get this week, you get this week, you get this week. Yeah. So you have to do some of that yourself. That is something that you don't quite get out of the box, but good question. He had a question first.
I was wondering, do you ever check out different types of configuration for the garbage collection?
Yeah, so the question was if we looked at other garbage collection methods, and we didn't really. We were using the CMS, the standard garbage collector, and switching to G1 helped a lot. It still kind of didn't get us where we needed to go, and we figured we were just using the wrong tool. We thought we could continue iterating and trying to fix this, but it was one of those moments of like there has to be a better way. And so we started looking, and it seemed like this API worked really well for us. So it was kind of like, hey, let's just do that. And actually, the transition was fairly seamless. So you had a question?
Yeah, so for the analytics thing, it looks like you're dropping files on disk and then reading them back into memory, breaking them into frames, parsing each frame, and throwing that into another service. Did you consider using concatenating those streams, like just grabbing the file as a stream of bytes from some service and then operating directly on them?
So your question is dropping the files locally somewhere instead of moving about, worrying about pushing them?
With file I/O, right, you're reading from disk. I was just wondering if there was a way that you could read those bytes directly over the network and not
hit unfortunately, we wanted that, but we're working with a third party here. So they, at the time, just provided their API for us.
We get it as it's a tarred, it's like a tarred.
Yeah, we basically get large files that they end up pulling. They just stick those in S3 and they pull it. We pull those out. Ideally it'd be, a stream of data coming from them, but that's what we had to work with. So the file source was actually pretty useful for that. It was nice. You basically have a file source, and then you frame it, and you basically have, the data you want.
Great.
Yeah.
Just curious.
Yeah.
Question over here.
How do you ensure what is being read is being written on the same? How do you ensure the quality of the logs?
Yeah, I think some of that starts with unit testing, and we didn't really talk a lot about the semantics around unit testing. So. Some of the unit tests you do there, you break out your stream into different inputs and outputs, and you can test each stage of the stream, which helps. And then otherwise, the stream provides tools for you to do some of that. So, I think in production, you can, is your question more about how do you monitor and test for that, or how do you, what's your?
So, my underlying question is more of a validation side of that. So, say, for example, if you're looking at structured data from Kafka, and that is being just today,
I think offline, unless you have something. I think it's much, much larger discussion there, but it's okay.
Cool.
I hope that's a common problem.
Yes. All right. Thank you all.
Thanks so much.
Thank you. Nice to be here. And so the title of my talk will be Twitter Heron in Practice. How many of you know about Twitter Heron in the first place? OK, not many, looks like. Considering the fact that the paper has been downloaded close to 18,500 times. So OK, so I'll be giving a kind of a little bit overview of what Twitter Heron does. And so feel free to ask me any questions that you might have, because I have a lot of details in my head, but unless you ask me questions, then only the details will come out, you know. So anyway, so with that short introduction, I will be delving into the talk. So the talk outline goes as follows. And initially, I will give an overview about what Heron is. And we are kind of introducing the notion of what we call as a micro-streaming engines. And then I will discuss in detail a couple of problems that we face when Twitter Heron is running at a large scale for the last two and a half years. And then I will delve more detail into what are the resource conception of Heron itself. And finally, I'll do the conclusions. So as you all know, Twitter is all about real time. And we do a lot of real time processing. And that includes computing real time trends based on analyzing the tweets, what is the emerging news that is coming out. And also, there are a lot of real-time conversations. So millions and millions of real-time conversation flows through those tweets. And in order to identify and bubble up those conversations, we need to employ real-time processing. And also, we do real-time recommendations. When we inject an ad, we inject into the stream depending upon the context. And those contexts are continuously computed, and the ad is injected in real-time. And finally, we also have real-time search, where the tweets have to be indexed the moment it arrives within 100 milliseconds, so that the results of the search can include the newly or the fresh tweets as well, so that it feels very close to real time. So which means we are collecting billions and billions of events, and how to process these events in order to provide all these various different real time processing is a big challenge for us. And initially, as you all know, in 2011, we open sourced Storm, and Storm was one of our mainstay for the, from 2011 to 2013. Then we faced a lot of issues with Storm. I would suggest, like, I'm not going to reiterate all the problems that we faced with respect to Storm, but I would suggest to read the paper that I will point out to the paper, and please read about it if you wanted to know more about it. And so I'm going to jump directly into Heron itself. So just to give a overview of Heron, I will introduce the Heron terminology. And Heron terminology, we just borrowed from Storm, and to keep it simple, so it's that the notion of a real-time job is called a topology, and a topology is nothing but an ace DAG, and the vertices of the DAG represents the computation, and the edges of data, sorry, edges between the vertices are essentially streams of data tuples. And there are two type of vertices, spouts, and spouts essentially like what they do is they tap into the data source and extract the data and inject the data into the job itself. And some of the examples include Kafka, Kestrel, and how many of you know that Twitter has open sourced their new queuing system or messaging system called the distributed log? Okay, there you go. So it's pretty very good. It has been in production, like 60 or 70% of our topologies are running in distributed log now. And so it doesn't mean that we have to stick with only messaging systems, but also with the MySQL and Postgres and a few others as well. The second one is bowls. And the second type of vertices is called bowls. And bowls are essentially represents computational elements where you process incoming tuples and emit outgoing tuples, depending upon how the processing goes. And some of the examples include filtering, aggregation, join, or any arbitrary functions. So how does a Heron topology looks like? Like, you have a couple of spouts feeding into the next stage bowls, which are like bowl 1, bowl 2, and bowl 3. And they are in turn feed to the next stage of bowls, bowl 4 and bowl 5. And one of the biggest differences like compared to MapReduce is the fact that there's no limit to the number of stages that you can stitch to. You can stitch as many stages as you want. We have jobs internally that is running like more than around 10 stages or 15 stages. That's common. So the word count, to give a concrete example of how a topology looks like, let's take the example of a word count where you are counting the stream of words that are coming out of tweets. So in order to accomplish this, you need a tweet spout, which in turn taps into the Twitter feed. And that tweet spout will parse it, the tweet, entire tweet into what you call a parse tweet bowl, which is responsible for breaking the tweet into a smaller set of words. And finally, you have a word count bowl, which in turn counts the distinct words that is occurring across the tweets, so that you can spit out the count in a periodic fashion. And from a database parlance, we call this as a DAG or something called a logical plan. And but in reality, when this topology runs in physical machines, it's a completely different ballgame. Reason why is like you might not be able to process the data in a single process or even a single machine. And because of that, like you end up having multiple instances of each one of those elements in the DAG. So the way the same topology will work in the physical machines is like you have tasks. So you have the tweet spout task, which are several of them. And similarly, there's a parse tweet bowl task, which could be several of them. And you can configure each one of those stages or each one of these nodes in the DAG by using a parallelism parameter. So, and you have a word count bowl tasks as well. So now all these tasks could be distributed across all the machines and they will continue to run. And the size of your number of tasks is proportional to the amount of data that you wanted to process at every stage. Now, one of the main issues, when a parse tweet bowl emits the data, on one of the tasks emits the data, which task in the downstream it has to go to. So that is where the notion of stream groupings come into play. And so first is shuffle grouping. You have a random distribution of tuples and it can go to any task downstream. And the fields grouping essentially takes the fields of some of the tuple and groups them, and based on the value of the fields, it picks up the task downstream. Then the third aspect is called all grouping, which is replicates the tuples across all the tasks. And finally, like you have this global grouping, which sends the entire stream to one single task. So most of the time, probably like 95 to 99% of the time, you use a combination of shuffle grouping, fields grouping, or one of those. So now getting back to the word count topology, how do you annotate the topology with the grouping information? So as you can see, from a tweet to a parse tweet bowl, the tweet can be processed by any parse tweet bowl, which means a shuffle grouping will suffice there. On the other hand, when you go from a parse tweet bowl to a word count bowl, you should be doing fields grouping because you want the same word from across different tweets to be end up in the same task. So this, with this introduction, I'm going to move into why we did Heron when we had Storm in the first place. So there was a lot of things that we looked up, and especially after operating Storm on several thousands of clusters. So what we did is like one of the major issues was performance predictability. So it was Storm was having issues in terms of how to predict the performance from an end-to-end point of view, as well as the individual bolt and tasks and all the various stuff, right? So how do you have a system where you can predict your performance? Second one is like improve developer productivity. So we found that Storm jobs are very challenging to debug. And that caused a lot of developer productivity in terms of trying to figure out a needle in the haystack where, hey, what bolt and what instance of the bolt and on what machine it is running is causing issues. How do you improve those? So how do you improve the developer productivity such a way that you can quickly get your bugs fixed and move on? And finally, like ease of manageability. I mean, one of the major things that we had with respect to Storm was we were running on different cluster on its own. And so whereas we wanted to, as a team, we don't want to maintain our own clusters and everything. Instead, we wanted to kind of run it alongside the critical services that serves Twitter and all the other services. And it should be running as a part of those big clusters that we have so that we don't have to manage clusters and all the various stuff. So that ease of manageability and the developer productivity and performance predictability are the three main reasons why we started doing Heron. So now what are the Heron design decisions? First of all, it should be fully API compatible with Storm. And the reason why we ought to be API compatible with Storm, there are a lot of legacy code that has been already written on top of it and they are all in production. And we have to make sure that we can migrate them seamlessly without having to do anything at all. So without any code changes and any developer's time. So which means the notion of a DAG applies, topologies, spouts, and bowls apply, and all the APIs are compatible. The second aspect was task isolations. So we wanted to have the notion where each of the spout and bowls are running on a task of its own or a process of its own, so that you have the ability to do profiling and doing resource isolations and all the various other aspects that comes along with it. So then finally, we used mainstream languages, which is like C++, Java, and Python. So because the team was, the storm was returned in closure, we did not have enough tools for that language in order to make that development as fast as we could. So hence, we resorted to writing some of the critical components in these mainstream languages. So any questions before I go further deeper into Heron? Okay, cool. Hope I'm very clear. So anyway, so the first thing, design decision is like we got away from a scheduler. So as everybody knows, Storm had its own set of scheduler for scheduling tasks in a cluster of machines. So we moved away from it. The reason we moved away from it is because the scheduler have their own set of communities, like Apache Mesos, Yarn, and then there are some frameworks that are developed on top of these schedulers, Apache Aurora, then Marathon, then we have EC, yes, which is Amazon Docker Container Service. There are so many of them. So instead of introducing yet another one and adding into the mix, instead what we did is let's take a piggyback on an existing scheduler. And so whenever you submit a topology, it looks like yet another job for the scheduler so that it can schedule the topology also alongside with other jobs. So that's what we did. So any topology that you submit is goes to the regular schedulers, and that in turn gets the resources that each topology wants it, and each topology is run as a separate job. So if you look at how the entire topology runs, so we have this notion of a topology master, which is responsible for the life cycle of the entire topology, and that is running in a special container called the container zero. And when I say container, it's nothing but a C group container that Linux supports, so which allows you to have a nicely resource isolations, and so that whatever the resources that you allocate for that container, like X CPUs and the Y amount of memory that you like to allocate for the container, does not get exceeded. So that when multiple containers are sharing the same node, you don't exceed your quota, so that it does not affect any performance of the other topologies or other services that are running alongside in a multi-tenant cluster. So the topology master runs in the container zero, and the topology master comes up first and looks at its DAG and finds out how much resources that it needs to allocate and requests that much of resources from the scheduler. And the topology also saves its state, which is essentially the DAG, and some of the execution state, which includes who launched the topology, what time it launched, what version of the Heron it's running on, all kind of various stuff, which is called the execution state, is all returned into a zookeeper cluster. The reason being it's returned into a zookeeper cluster is the container zero can fail. The topology master can fail in a distributed system. So which means like if the container zero fails and the scheduler moves the container to somewhere else, that container will come up and the topology will, master will come up again and will pick up the state from the zookeeper so that it doesn't lose any state. And the topology master is not even involved during the data path. It just is involved only in the control path. As long as any changes in the physical plan, logical plan is stored, that is the state it maintains. So then once the resources are acquired from the scheduler, then these containers are scheduled by the data containers are scheduled by the scheduler itself. And each of these containers contains something called a stream manager. And there is a notion of a metrics manager. And there are I1 through I4. These are all nothing but instances. And these instances are the ones that run your spout task and the bolt task. Remember I was mentioning about the word count topology, which contain the tweet spout and the parse tweet bolt. Those tasks run in these instances I1 through I4. And the stream manager is responsible for moving the data around across the containers. So essentially, when data is emitted from these I1 and I2 and I3, so data gets into the stream manager. From the stream manager, it goes to the other stream manager before the data is delivered into the other instances. So even if the instances in the same container want to exchange data, they can bounce off from the stream manager as well. So you can think about stream manager as what you call a data router. So where it routes the data to the appropriate task from its source. So that's what it does. And the metrics manager essentially is one that collects all the metrics coming out of these various instances. And the number of metrics that we collect is so huge. I mean, because whenever some topology goes into some kind of a state, we need to know what happened with the topology right away. So because of that, we collect several hundreds metrics about the topology, including how much tuples it has processed, how much bytes it has processed, what is the latency it experiences, how much bytes it pushed into the stream manager, all kind of statistics, whatever you can think of. And how many times the container got killed and rescheduled, how many times the process got restarted, all kind of statistics like that is collected. And those things are sent to an offline system. So,
Sure.
So it could be mapped to a Docker container, but in production we don't use Docker containers. Instead, we use the we map a container to a Linux C group containers.
Gotcha.
Yes.
In terms of metrics, it would be interesting looking at you from a whole task from end to end, and the metrics kind of collecting those
yes.
observations.
So like currently we aggregate the information all coming out of those containers. So but we have information about every spout and bolt and all the various informations also is available. So that you can look at whether a particular spout is the one that is causing the issue or a particular bolt is causing the issue, you can do all of them.
Yeah, but you can correlate that to the application that you are running.
No, this is for only for operations, yes. So there are some user-defined metrics. For example, as a user of a topology, where I am interested in collecting some metrics, you can do that as well, which is called user-defined metrics. We also allow that. And that metrics also is pumped to wherever you tell it has to go to. So that also we do that. But for operational purposes, we collect hundreds of metrics so that if some topology that is in production, they come running to us, hey, there's something wrong with it, we should be able to locate the problem very quickly enough then so that you can turn around quickly, right? So, yes. So. Yeah, Zipkin is for tracing, but this is more online. Immediately you can check the metrics itself, yes. So then when the topology actually gets executed in the physical nodes, so this is what you'll see. So you have these four containers, and some of the instances of the bolts and the spouts are running in these containers, and you have this notion of stream managers in this container, right? Now what happens is once these containers come up, the stream managers kind of what do you call it, interact, or rather they do a fully connected graph where each of the stream manager connects to the other stream manager, and that's the only way they can start exchanging data right away. So any data that is put into the topology from the spout S1 on the top left container will get into the stream manager before it goes to the other stream managers. And the advantage of using stream manager has is several aspects. For example, it reduces the number of resources in terms of the sockets and ports from order of n squared to order of k squared, where k is the number of containers as compared to k is where n is the number of instances of various spout and bolt who directly connect to their respective downstream components, right? And another advantage of isolating the stream manager code is you can write any kind of parsing semantics that you'd like to. So it's like, for example, at least once, at most once, exactly once. And you can even make one stream manager for each one of them. So some of the Heron topologies that we're running include the shapes of this form. So you have a simple topologies to all the way to complex topologies, as I mentioned. And some of the topologies are generated by the Summingbird, which is a Scala interface that we run on top of Heron. Heron, you can think about as an engine. And Summingbird is the API that we use. And that API in turn generates these several topologies, complex topologies. Some of the topologies that are smaller are these ones are directly written on the Heron API itself. So, yes.
So the topology that must be instantiated ahead of time.
Yes.
Or you can do any computation.
So the topology,
the DAG
shape should be instantiated. The DAG, like for example,
also
so resources can be assigned dynamically.
Okay.
So like when the topology master comes up, you can tell I need this many containers, right? Yes, but the DAG itself has to be instantiated because that is the contains of processing logic, right? So Heron at Twitter has been in production for more than 2 years now, and obviously I can't tell the exact numbers, but we are processing tons of data and. Probably like the number of nodes that are running in Heron is like probably a few thousand nodes. So it's all fully running Heron itself. So some of the use cases at a high level is real-time ETL, real-time BI, and product safety like fraud detection, spam detections, and all the various stuff, and computing real-time trends, and a real-time ML in terms of model building and model enhancements. And we also do some kind of real-time media as well in terms of processing and real-time ops. Some of the operational data is continuously processed in order to spit out some analytics and based on which quickly decisions are made. So these are some of the high-level use cases. And so I'm going to go delve into more of a couple of problems that we kind of solved in production. And I just want to highlight those things with that short introduction to Heron. So the first thing is componentizing Heron. The big data ecosystem is continuously evolving. A lot of new technologies coming in and going away and all this stuff, right? So as you can see, the heterogeneous system with respect to Heron at least is there are multiple several schedulers, like managed schedulers, unmanaged schedulers, then the state managers, which could be a zookeeper or even a local file system or even a Hadoop, which provides some kind of synchronization mechanism. And the job uploaders, once you have your jar, how do you upload that jar, right? That could be anything from an S3 to a local file system or even Hadoop in this case. So this ecosystem is continuously evolving in some fashion or other. So how do you design a system such that your dependencies on this ecosystem is minimal and the core does not change enough and all? So when we did that, we looked back. I mean, one of the things that I always believe in is the computer science revisits itself when every 20 to 30 years in some fashion. So I said, okay, let's go back and look in what people have done in early stages, right? So one of the things that we came up with was microkernels. So there was a notion of monolithic kernels where everything was written as own single software. That's what used to be the state of the art at the time. So where you have the hardware, device driver, scheduler, virtual memory, then IPC file systems, and even a virtual file system on top of it on where the actual file systems are mapped. And they saw that why you have to do a monolithic, instead they took only the necessary pieces and moved everything to the more at the application level. So that's what called the microkernel. And microkernel has the hardware and the basic IPC and a few things, and the rest of the other things were moved to the more application level. And we kind of were inspired by that, and Heron design also follows that. So we have the basic, the basic thing that you require is the IPCs, essentially a way to communicate between processes in some fashion, running on top of hardware. Then everything is the modules. Like everything is a process and modules that you written on top of it. So what happens is you can go and replace anything you want. I mean, for example, I want to write my own high-speed instances and everything. All you need to do is instance interact with Stream Manager through a protocol. And as long as you can implement your protocol, then you're done. You can write your own instances as well. And similarly, you can write your own metrics manager. Already we have return metrics manager that can go to send data to Scribe as well as Graphite and all the various stuff. And whereas the Stream Manager also can be replaceable because of the plug and play kind of architecture. And Topology Master's logic, where you wanted to do something cool, you can go and add that as well. So essentially, every component is replaceable in some fashion or other. So we don't call Heron as a streaming engine anymore. Instead, we call it as more of a streaming framework where you can add your functionalities that you like to. So what are the advantages of this architecture? It's plug and play. As environment changes, code does not change. And also multi-language instances is possible because today some of the multi-language related API, they don't run in the native language instances. Instead, here you can write your own instance. For example, today the supported API uses Java API, so which means we have a Java instances. And if you want to write a Python API for writing your topologies quickly enough, then you can write a multi-language, one of the instances like Python instances, and boom, then the Python code will execute in the native Python interpreter as compared to you having data coming from a Java process into a Python process so that it can execute. All those other stuff you don't need to do, actually. In fact, there is some work going on already to write a Python instance as well. So then multiple processing semantics that you can support. Then similarly, since it's all componentized and multiple team members can work on individual components separately, and it's very fast for development as well. So the Heron environment. So as I said, like we have multiple environments for Heron in within Twitter itself. So for example, our development environment uses a notion of a local scheduler where you can bring up entire Heron running topologies into the single laptop. And it also uses a local state manager, which is essentially like a synchronization mechanism. And for that, we use the local file system and a local uploader where, again, we use local file system to upload your jobs and run it. And that is when our primary, what do you call, development environment where we iterate very quickly, fast enough. And it runs as though it is running on a distributed system itself. So it's easy to, for example, if I introduce the bug in Steam Manager, then I can just GDB into the Steam Manager, boom, and I can debug that right away. So it's very fast and easy for development. Second one is like for cluster and testing, we run it on Meso/Aurora scheduler and with Zookeeper as state manager, then we use HDFS for the uploader, and that is used for testing purposes in a distributed systems. And our production runs in Aurora scheduler, which is the managed scheduler that is written on top of Mesos. And we have a Zookeeper state manager and the Packer uploader. Packer uploader essentially manages versions of topologies and all the various things. For example, your topology might go through various versions depending upon the functionality, bug fixes that we've added, and it can manage the versions of the topology as well. And that's what runs in production. So within Twitter context itself, we have multiple environment. And there are other groups which have taken Heron and running it on AWS as well. I've not included them, but they're running it on top of AWS as well too. So now, why Aurora? I mean, Aurora has been one of the very widely used scheduler within Twitter, and it manages hundreds and thousands of machines. So a lot of critical services run on top of Aurora itself. So the Heron runs in the context of Aurora in a multi-tenant cluster alongside with the other critical services as well. So then it allows you to provide authorization and expressive DSL to write your jobs. And it's also very high availability and scalability because there's a team behind it which manages the whole show for Aurora, and a lot of inbuilt metrics for monitoring and debugging as well. So with that discussion about componentizing Heron, I'm going to go into the next problem that we face in production. It's called stragglers and back pressure. This is a very interesting topic, actually. So stragglers are the norm in a distributed system. When you have a distributed system, there are several reasons why some process might be slow. I mean, especially some process that is running a part of as a single job could be slower. There are three primary reasons for it. One is a bad host. Like 80% of the time, we say, hey, by the way, like the machine that the job got scheduled is bad, because it could be having some RAM errors or some disk errors or whatever might be the case. Especially when you're running on a few hundred thousand node clusters, some bad apples will pop up here and there. So that's a commonly observed problem why stragglers start occurring. The next one is execution skew, which is essentially like a manifestation of the data hitting one process, a lot of data hitting one process because of the hotkey problems. Then the third one is what we have seen is inadequate provisioning. So if a job requires some X amount of provisioning in terms of resources, but you're not given the enough X, stragglers will start occurring as well. So now what are the approaches to handle stragglers? So the first thing is whenever a straggler occurs or whenever there's a straggler in your job, you can send data to the straggler, but it'll slow down everything. So now the simple strategy is when the sender figures out I can't send as faster to the receiver, which is the straggler, I simply drop data. So that's one approach. The second approach is slow down the senders to the speed of the straggler itself, so that everybody is going at the pace of the straggler. So in this case, there will be predictability and accuracy and all the various stuff. And detect stragglers and reschedule them. So proactively detect stragglers and reschedule them in some form or the other. So the drop data strategy. So what happens with the drop data? So it's very unpredictable. So if the machine is going really slow, you can continuously drop data. And there are instances that we have seen is a 2 to 3x inaccuracies. So for example, Storm was doing this drop data strategy. With that, what happened was like when the data was being shared with some of the potential partners, they saw 2x to 3x inaccuracy in during certain times. And that became affects accuracy quite a bit, especially if you are trying to share some essentially critical data. And also it gives poor visibility in terms of where it is being dropping and all this thing, because especially if a job is running on a few hundred machines, how do you know which one the guy is dropping data, which is very difficult to locate it. So the slowdown center strategy. So in this case, it provides predictability. And depending upon how the stragglers are not present, it processes the data at the maximum rate and also reduces recovery times. Whenever some thing fails, immediately it will pick up. It gets rescheduled on a different node, and it is going really as fast as it can. So then it can nicely handle temporary spikes. So if you delve more into the strategy, essentially let us take a simple linear topology which has a single spout, followed then in turn goes into a bolt B2, and that in turn feeds into a bolt B3, and another one bolt called bolt B4. Now, so as I said, there are four containers that are running these spouts and bowls, and you have these stream managers which are running in those containers, and they are the ones which are providing the data path for exchanging data. Now let's say for the sake of discussion, the B2 is going slow. And the moment when B2 goes slow, the stream manager detects that the B2 is going slow, then it will send that, what do you call, initiate back pressure or initiate like a slowdown strategy to all the other stream managers. So now the stream managers, when they look at their instances on this respective containers, and when they see a spout, they say that we are not going to accept any more data. So what we are trying to do in this strategy is the source of the data is the spouts. So if you're not taking any more data from the spouts, then the pace of the topology could be controlled. Right, so by choosing when to pick up the data and not to pick up the data, you are going at the pace of whatever the straggler is. So which means everybody slows down. So everybody slows down to the pace of B2. So now when B2 picks up speed, then everybody will start picking up speed, because there will be another message that sends out saying that, hey, by the way, back pressure is relieved, everybody can go at a high rate, right? And the way we do that is we have a notion of a watermark, high watermark and low watermark in buffers, and by using those watermark buffers, you can adjust when to kick off the back pressure and when to relieve the back pressure. So the back pressure in practice, when we looked at it, so if back pressure is kicking in so heavy, then you will fall back in the read part of it, because you're pushing the back pressure to the source. Now once you hit the source, and if the source is not consuming enough data, then you know clearly that you're falling behind. And one of the measurements that we make is the lag. So how much is the read versus the write lag is there, and that is proportional to the whether the topology is going at the input rate or it's lagging behind. So that is a measure that we use in order to figure out if there is any issues in the topology or not. So if that is the case, sometimes what happens is the back pressure might not recover. So we manually shoot down that container, and the container gets rescheduled, automatically restarts. So back pressure in practice. So most of the scenarios, back pressure recovers and without any manual intervention, and which is a nice thing. And there are some instances where we face sustained back pressure, and that's partially attributed to bad or faulty host and irrecoverable GC cycles. So one of the things that we are looking at into it right now is doing anomalies detections within these containers and the spout instances and all the various instances, so that we can detect this bad and faulty host, then we automatically shoot down that container so that the container gets rescheduled somewhere else without any manual interventions. So that is the problem that we are looking at in detail. And sometimes users prefer dropping off the data. So some people say, no, I want to be at the top of the queue always. If the processing is not done on time, we might lose some other asset, but I don't mind being inaccurate. So for that, we use sampling-based approaches. So since then, how do you detect bad and faulty host? We use another Heron topology to detect them. So the hundreds and thousands of machines that are there, and we have a Heron topology that detects those data coming from those and analyzes data, see whether that topologies or not topologies, any bad host is present, then you go and put the feedback and take it out, that machine out of service. So I'm going to skip the load shedding section, and instead I'm going to go into the resource usage of Heron. So one of the things the people have talked about is, yes. Can you keep the question a little bit later? I have only 5 minutes. Okay. So yeah. So the Heron resource usage, we took a two-node topology. One is the event spout, and another is an aggregate bowl. And the event spout takes 60 to 100 million tuples and filters the tuples to 8 to 12 million. And then we do a flat map, which essentially blow up of the tuples. Which essentially, like once we filter, these tuples are broken up into 5 times, so that the amount of data that is coming out is 40 to 60 million tuples per minute. And that is given to the aggregate bowl, which aggregates every 1 second, and it outputs around 25 to 40 million tuples per minute, writes it to Redis. Now let us see how the resource usage was. So Heron requested 120 resources to the scheduler, but the actual usage was 30 to 50 cores. And memory requested was 200 GB, but memory used was just 180. And the Redis, we had 24 cores requested, but hardly used 2 to 4 cores. And now zooming in, where the resources are actually going. So if you look at it, 84% goes into the spout instances. It's very unintuitive, where the data that we're fetching from Kafka or whatever it is, those are the ones which are taking the huge amount of time or the huge amount of resources. The bowls hardly do 9%, and Heron over is hardly 7%. So now profiling into spouts to figure out where the actual time is going, so we can see like the deserialized cost is 63%, and parsing and filtering take 6%, and taking it out of the Kafka iterator as well as the Kafka fetch take 16 plus 7, that is like around 26% or some, like 24 plus 3, 23%. So as it says, the fetching data, which is 63 plus 16 plus 7, that's close to 80 to 85% of the whole spout is gone to fetching data itself. If you eliminate that overhead, and if you take the binary, raw binary, then we might even shave off all those things. So now profiling bowls, again, like going to writing data into Redis, that takes 68% of the data. Remember, the overall grand scheme of things, bolt is taking much more lower compared to spouts itself. Then again, serialization and deserialization takes around 20%. And some of the aggregation data transport takes only small amount of percentage. So effectively, like fetching data costs you more, like 61%, and user logic takes 21%, Heron usage is 11%, and we have room in Heron to make it even 3x and 4x faster, but this is adequate enough to most of the processing at this point. So now one more numbers, like in terms of one of the topology that mimics production topology. It counts the real-time active count where people are interacting with Twitter. So some of the CPU usage, as you can see, the number of cores used versus Heron versus when you are at least once and at most once, the number of cores is significantly reduced in Heron itself. So the Heron overall saved like 3x to 4x worth of cost in terms of the number of machines and cores that we use. And if you want to learn more, so we have a bunch of papers. So Storm at Twitter, which was written in Sigmod 2014, Sigmod 2015, Twitter Heron. Then this is a new paper that's coming out. Then if you wanted to do more, a compendium of real-time analytics, so we did a tutorial in VLDB 2015. This is 180 slides of a lot of hardcore in-depth content. So if you are interested, please go and take. It's all available in SlideShare, so you can take a look at it. And that's all I had. I think I a little bit rushed, but hopefully everybody got the gist of it. Yes, please. Thank you. So any questions? I have 10 minutes for questions. Yes. Which is the last three slides?
No, three slides back to graph.
Oh, the graph? Okay. So any questions?
How do you do the profile for the bowls?
So it's like, since the bowls and the spouts are running on a process of its own, you can do heap dump and urkit and all that. You can attach it right away, and you can start profiling. So remember, like, unlike a Storm worker, where multiple spout instances, bold instances are running in a single thread, multiple threads within a single worker, that is not there anymore. So everything is a process. So the fundamental difference between Storm and Heron is a more process-oriented architecture as compared to a thread-oriented architecture. Yes. Yes.
You mentioned in the case of compute skew, and that caused kind of that
hotkey problem. Yes.
Yeah. Then you still use what kind of strategy do you use?
So typically, like when that happens, which is a very rare thing if it happens. So now, when that happens, if the topology is prone to that, typically what we do is doing map side aggregations. So what we have, people go back and add a map side aggregation, which is another stage that they introduce in the topology, then they relaunch it. So that is the way we have been doing it now. And if you wanted to do it dynamically, it's very difficult actually. But because introducing a new stage on the fly and getting it computed and taking that stage away, right? So instead, we found that in practice, it's better to do the what you call the source of the problem itself, because there are hotkeys, because Twitter is known for high skew always, and people are aware of that, so they always tend to kind of have a discipline of having a map side aggregation before they do the next two level aggregations, right? So that reduces the hotkey. So the first stage hits the what you call the raw data, then some partial aggregation happen, then after that do the overall aggregation. Yes. Any other questions? Yes.
This is open source yet, right?
It's on its way.
That's
right.
Yeah.
When's it going to be open source?
Well, you will hear from us.
Do you
I would say weeks.
Oh, weeks.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. No, I couldn't hear you. So this was compared with 0.8, I think. So, but we after that we never did that. And the Storm community said that they have improved some performance. But once it comes out, somebody picks it up and does a performance, that'll be awesome. Okay, sure. Any other question?
Yeah.
Okay, sure. So like, as I mentioned, remember like one of the things that I mentioned is Heron is built for any scheduler you can. So currently, as I said, we are running on locally with a local scheduler. We have native Meso scheduler, we have Aurora scheduler, and some people are working on Neon scheduler as well. And some of the people are even working on some HPC community wanted to work on something called Slurm scheduler, which is essentially in a supercomputing nodes. They want to run it on several thousands of nodes, but the file system is shared and they have the different scheduler and all, right? So the scheduler abstraction is clean enough that you can write your own scheduler probably in a week or two, so if you want it. But most, I think like there is quite a few schedulers will be available already. Sure. Yeah. Anything? Any other questions? Okay, thank you.